Pixelkin.
My name is Joshua Wire. I've been at Valve for about 15 years now. I started back in Half-Life 2 and then worked through all the different projects, and most recently I was the project lead for Portal 2.
You listed Portal actually as one of our top picks for families to play for family game night. Do you ever play Portal with your family?
One of the cool experiences I had is that my brother, who's about 8 years younger than I am, was really into gaming, and so it was really fun to play co-op with him because it was a game that I had worked on, but also a game that we could kind of play together as brothers. And I think that was pretty neat, especially because it was cooperative. So when you're playing together that way, it's just a really different type of experience, right? It's not competitive. It's like, oh man, we got to do this, we got to do that, and you're talking to the person, trying to work with them, and it just feels so cool when you finish a puzzle and you can both, you know, give each other a high five, and you know, you got through it together, which
is
neat.
That's one of the reasons we like it so much.
Yeah.
And having built the game, was it an interesting? Did you know all the secrets when you were playing with him, or was it more of an exploration?
I didn't. That was the fun part. So I worked more heavily on the single player aspect, and there were some really awesome people on the team who bought, you know, kind of took co-op and they ran with it, and so I didn't have his eyes on with that because they were doing their thing, they were doing an awesome job. So I was like, great, you guys run with it. So the benefit was that when we finally got time to be able to play it, I could actually play it like, you know, one of our customers would play it, not like me going, oh, I see a bug here, you know, that was going to be something different. So it was pretty cool because, yeah, usually by the time we finish games, it's like, I don't want to see this again. We've played it a million times looking for bugs, or, you know, I know something was going to be one way, but we made it this way. So, yeah, it was pretty cool to do. Probably the biggest reason that we did co-op in Portal 2 is a lot of people had that sort of ad hoc co-op where, especially in Portal 1, somebody would be playing and somebody would sit down on the couch with them and start helping them work through it. And we're like, well, we should just really formalize that and put a controller on the other person's hand. And then we did, and it was great. And I think one of the most interesting things that came out of that is that it taught me how to solve problems better, because we quickly learned that we could throw really hard problems at pairs of people, not necessarily because you had two heads, but because they would have to talk about a problem. And it's really fascinating because when somebody had to stop and go, okay, I think what we want to do is this and then this, they go, oh, and then they go, I know what to do now, right? So even in programming, we call that rubber duck, where you have a little rubber duck and you tell your problem to it, and it doesn't have to know what you're saying, it's just you're verbalizing it, so you're sort of making that problem concrete. And that happened in Portal 2 as well. You know, people would sit down and describe what they wanted to do, and then that was the key thing that made them do it. And we'd kind of found that informally, because we do a lot of play testing to learn if we're crazy or not, basically. And so we would sit somebody down at a puzzle, and they'd thrash at it for a while, and when it was clear that they were going to give up, we'd sit down and say, okay, well, tell us what you're trying to do. And, you know, 90% of the time, they would have that same aha moment where they'd describe what they're doing and go, oh, duh, and then they'd be embarrassed and they'd want us to go away so they could, you know, finish the puzzle. So that was a really cool and interesting kind of side thing that came of the co-op that I don't think we expected, but it was neat to see. I think it's pretty cool to be able to play cooperatively with kids. Again, that's one thing I thought that was really exciting about Portal 2 is that I think we had like a three-year-old play through with his dad. And, you know, probably the three-year-old wasn't doing all the cognitive things, but I think that was this really interesting social bonding thing that they were having, and you know, the dad in that case really loved games and he was having fun, and I think that ability to share with his younger child is really important, and I think that's pretty neat. You know, you look at Minecraft, it's huge with kids right now. I mean, they just love it. It's very creative. There's a lot of cool building blocks with it, but usually when I hear parents talk about it, it's just like, it's Minecraft, I don't know, it doesn't make any sense to me. So it'd be really neat to find ways to sort of bridge that gap too, so that we have a couple people here who do play that with their kids, and they just have these really fun discussions where they're talking about, well, I don't know, how would you build this? Like, let's figure it out. And they kind of like set little problems for their kids inside the game world. And that's pretty neat. Yeah, and I think if you look at games like that, there's literal building blocks that can add up to these really amazing things. And I think it would probably be pretty transformative for a kid to go, oh, I've known about these three separate things, but if I combine them in this clever way, it makes something new. What else could I combine, right? Like, suddenly that's this aha moment of like, I have this toolkit, what else could I do with it, right? And that's always funny too, because, you know, as adults, I think we look at that and go, it must be nice to have that time, but that's the magic of kids, right? Like, they've got that time, they've got that dedication, they're obsessed with making this thing happen. So I think those are gonna be tomorrow's 3D modelers, you know, their next game designers, because that bug is gonna stay with them. So yeah, if kids can get in on that, even if they just make something that's super simple. I mean, if they make a mod where they turn something green, that's pretty awesome, right? Like, you got to reach behind the curtain and tweak something, and then suddenly that thing that seems so amazing and unreal, you can relate to a little bit more, and you can go, oh, I can actually do this. I can get closer to it. So I think that's pretty empowering and cool. I think the most interesting thing for me with Portal 2 specifically is that we really tried to keep it open for everybody. Like, we wanted it to be an E for Everyone game because we just felt like Portal 1 already was that, even though it wasn't rated that way. When we playtested it, we would bring in kids who were like 8 years old, and they were smarter than us half the time, all the way up to people who were like much, much, much older outside of what you typically think games were. And at one point, we brought some kids in, and I think that we have a video up online that actually has kids using our more hardcore tools to make, you know, Portal levels. And that was really neat because for me as a kid, I had to go through all these hoops to try to make games work because I'd so desperately wanted to make games, and it was so hard back then. And I think that was part of the inspiration for why we made the PETI, perpetual testing initiative for Portal 2, where users can make their own maps inside the game. And so I think when we put that piece online and brought the kids back in, it was really amazing to see them just be freed up to do what they wanted to do. They didn't have to think about the tools. They didn't have to think about like thinking in 3D space. Those are things that come later once you've kind of got that hook. So I think the neat thing seeing it in schools isn't just that kids are able to do this, but I think that they're so excited to do it. And because it's this product that they've seen in the shelves and they didn't think it was educational, right? It didn't come to them as this is Math Blaster or this is something that has an agenda to teach you something. But yet at the end of it, they came away going, oh, I just made this button on the floor that opens a door and I made my own puzzle, and they could start to see behind the curtain of what we do. And I think that's always really interesting for users because people think, well, I'm not a designer, I can't do that. But then they do a little bit of it and they go, oh, okay, I start to understand the pieces here. And so my hope is that not just from an educational standpoint, but also I think those kids will be using this tool, and then I'm hoping in, you know, 10, 20 years, someone will say in an interview, oh, I got my start when I, you know, played with the Portal thing and I learned I really wanted to do this sort of thing, because that resonates with me, because when I was a kid, that's how I kind of got into gaming and really wanted to get the career I have. So I'm really excited to give that to people, hopefully. The funny thing about it was that we didn't ever build it as an educational package. It was always built as a game. But I think one of the things that works about Portal, and one of the key strategies we used, is that we teach you how to use portals because we have to. It's like there's nothing in nature that gives us any kind of bearing for how to do this.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah. I actually, that's a side thing. I always laugh that we've taught kids how to think with portals, which is kind of impossible, but still cool. It's still cool spatial reasoning. But anyway, so much of what we did was sitting down saying, okay, you need to know this about portals. Portals have this one specific thing, right? Maybe that's conservation of momentum. So you're going to go in a portal, you're going to fly to another. You can reason that out, you can think about that, but most people didn't, right? That's not what they're doing. They're playing the game, they're having fun. So we had to demonstrate, like, okay, well, here's a simple example of that. And we always talked about it with the structure of we'd kind of give you a lesson, we'd do a few little tests, and then we would give you what we called a graduation puzzle. So in a lot of ways, it was sort of like teaching you teaching you something in the classroom and then giving you the mini quiz, teaching you a little more and then giving you the full quiz, right? It just sort of worked out that way. And the cool thing is that we were able to make that fun, right? It wasn't just going, okay, I'm eating my vegetables, you know, I'm getting there, which you should eat your vegetables. I'm a vegetarian, so I always think it's funny when I use that term. But so it was really interesting for us to build that and to teach players and then give them that demonstration of mastery. I think that was another big aspect of it, which isn't just, okay, you've learned all that stuff, but then we would just twist it at the end. So you had to sort of not just do exactly what we've taught you by rote, you had to extend that one little step. And I think,
and apply it.
And I think that's the thing that, I guess, for our brains is just so tantalizing, that feeling of like, oh, not only do I know this, but now I can do this cool thing. And I think that was cool about Portal is that everybody had to do the same solution, but so many people felt like this was my solution, or I came up with it, or I'm the only one in the world that did this. And of course everyone did, but that was exciting to get people to come along with that. So the funny thing was that after we had built Portal, you know, Gabe came and talked to us because he was really interested in education, and he was like, hey, I think this would be a really interesting educational piece. And we kind of thought about it, and we're like, yeah, I guess it is. Like, we never thought about it that way. And then when we did the PETI, the perpetual testing initiative, where people could make maps, it just sort of doubled down on that. And it was like, oh, this is even better, because now all these things that we could have done before, we've just made way simpler and we've embedded into the product. So now we can just give that to schools, and it's just like, yeah, just install Steam and go nuts. So it was kind of neat that all this work that we had done sort of all came together in this really great secondary application, and that when kids play it, they're super excited, right? Like, they want to play Portal. They're so excited to be in that world, and then they're learning stuff along the way. And I think that's pretty cool as a game designer to see it used in so many contexts. For me, as somebody who, you know, I've always kind of been in this creative field, it's really neat to have creativity sort of reflected back to you from the people that you're you know, giving your work to, so to speak. You kind of put yourself out there, and then when they kind of put themselves out there again, that's very gratifying, and it's really exciting, and Portal's been a great series for that. I mean, I think more than any other, people just owned it, right? It's not like our other games. People really took this strong sense of identity with it. They really love that community. It's this in-joke that everybody knows, right? But it kind of binds people together in this cool way. So that's what I like, I think, the most about the series. It's just this really unique game in that way. And I was really proud to be a part of that.